So thank you very much for being here again today. I'm really pleased to start introducing the second day of the Disruption Network Club conference, Truth Tellers. I am Tatiana Bazzichelli, the director of the Disruption Network Club, and I would like, first of all, to thank a lot my wonderful collaborators, Kim Voss and Claudia Dorfmüller, for their work. And I just want to introduce briefly what is going to happen today. This will be this is actually the 10th event of the Disruption Network Club, and also the third event of the Art and Evidence series. We are funded by the Cultural Affairs Department of the Senate Chancellery of Berlin, or better, the Regierende Bürgermeister from Berlin, especially the funding program of the city tax. And we have a cooperation with the Kunstquartier Bethanien, and we work in collaboration with the Wow Holland Stiftung, Spectrum, Alexander von Humboldt Institute for Internet and Society, and XNET. For this specific event, we always have different partners. And then we have the support of the Free Chelsea Manning Initiative, and I really would like to ask you to sign the petition. There is still time for time served of Chelsea Manning. And I always want to repeat this thing because we have the table of information about Chelsea Manning's here. I really want to thank as well the Free Chelsea Manning Initiative for being here, and the petition can be signed online. So please do, because there is only a few days left. And so I wanted to introduce this topic also starting with Chelsea Manning, because yesterday we have been speaking a lot about whistleblowing and truth telling, and I think that especially now it's really important to address these topics when we have, you know, just heard a few days ago that there is a new president in US that claimed to tell the truth, and instead we know that is not really the case. So I think that an event about truth-telling is really important because also make us understand the importance of speaking out, and especially the activity of many people that do that, risking their life and also being in jail for a really long time. So for example, we spoke yesterday about Jeremy Hammonds and a lot of other whistleblowers. So I really want to thank again the people of yesterday for the great discussion and interaction. And today also we go on with our Truth Tellers, the Impact of Speaking Out program. And I also want to quote a bit myself, and especially the title that we, the subtitle that we gave, that is, can we trust the sources and can the sources trust us? And I think this is actually a really crucial question. And today we will try to speak about, from one side, the importance of speaking out and the importance to fight against you know, the hidden side of powers, but at the same time also we invited artists and activists that are playing with the discourse of the truth, because this we will analyze better in our panel. It's really important also to understand what the concept of truth means nowadays, and also imagine it as a space of intervention. And so we will start with our wonderful keynote, Mustafa Al-Bassam, and the keynote is entitled 50 Days of Lulz, and I'm actually really looking forward to that. I was really looking forward since last year, because we had Mustafa with us already last year in December. And it's funny because we always end up celebrating the last events of the year of the Disruption Lab together, so I really like that. And I will introduce now the moderator of Mustafa, that will introduce Mustafa better, is Gabriella Coleman. And thank you, Gabriella, for being here as well. She holds the Wolfe Chair in Scientific and Technological Literacy at McGill University, in Montreal, in Quebec, and she is also trained as an anthropologist that explored the interaction of the culture of hacking and politics. She also focuses on her work on the socio-political implication of the free software movement and the entity called Anonymous. She wrote a lot of things, actually, but the main thing I wanted to mention are her two books, Coding Freedom, The Ethics and Aesthetic of Hacking, that was published in 2012, and also the recent book that got also a prize that was published in 2014, Hacker, Hoaxer, Whistleblower, Spy, The Man in Faces of Anonymous. So we thought that the best person to introduce this keynote is Gabriella, and I'm really happy to welcome her on stage. Thanks a lot for being here.
Great. Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming out tonight. Can you hear me? Is that good enough? Okay. I usually don't write out my talks or introductions, but I wanted to make sure that I said certain things. I'm very, very excited to introduce tonight's keynote. So I wrote it out just to make sure I didn't miss anything. So on July 20th, 2011, various news outlets announced that the British Metropolitan Police had arrested a 16-year-old student in London. And more so, he was a hacker who had participated in the infamous hacktivist collective known as Anonymous. They did not publish his name, but they did publish his hacker nickname, Tflow. By this time, I had dedicated much of my time to the study of the pseudonymous entity. And Tflow was a name familiar to everyone and anyone who had spent any time on the rowdy Anonymous chat rooms. So when the news was published, I was really quite surprised to learn of his age, because everything about him pointed to someone who was perhaps a bit older, a bit more articulate than what we usually associate with male teenagehood. So as it turns out, my assumptions were wrong. So when I first heard that he was 16 and British, I thought he was white. I thought he came from an exceedingly wealthy British family. I assumed that he had been shipped off to some elite boarding school at too young of an age, and he was angry at his parents. I maybe thought, well, he was certainly contributing to Anonymous for political purposes. Perhaps he was also working out his anger and alienation through hacktivism. So when his name and picture were finally published, it was very clear that my initial mental picture had not only been wrong, but really a stereotype. And indeed, by the time his profile had been made public, I had already met various participants, some of them hackers, some of them not hackers, and many of them who had contributed in many different ways to Anonymous. And as I got to know people, a pattern emerged. Anonymous actually tended to scramble the human tendency to seek people out like ourselves. That is, we as humans tend to gravitate to people we find familiar. But thanks to the pseudo-anonymous conditions of this activist collective, it's really hard to know who lies behind the mask. There's actually a little bit more diversity than you would think among its participants, and this diversity falls along class, ethnic, and professional lines, and there's even more diversity outside of the hacker participants. So eventually, I was lucky enough to meet Mustafa in person. But I nearly botched our very first meeting due to a confusion over the address of the restaurant I picked, which was my fault, and the fact that I no longer own a cell phone. I got lost, he got lost, and we had no way of connecting or communicating. But we accidentally ran into each other on the street near the restaurant, and I'm very glad the gods of chance were looking out for us. By that time, many commentators had assumed that most, if not all, the hackers in Anonymous were juvenile. And I mean both in terms of their character, a juvenile character, as well as being young. And that they were uninterested in truth-telling and politics. Their hacking was fueled, many commentators felt, by a mix of rage and testosterone. After meeting Mustafa on the chat channels, and by meeting many other participants, I saw a very different reality. Some indeed had been very young, really young. Mustafa was only 15 when he first contributed to Anonymous. Others, like Jeremy Hammond, were older and had accrued over a decade of activist and hacktivist experience by the time they showed up. But just because Mustafa was barely a teenager did not mean he was devoid of a political sensibility. Talking to him that day in person over lunch, and then during my subsequent conversations, it was clear he had a very strong and clear sense of what was right and what was wrong. Sure, he was working through some of these principles, but this is a task all of us have to do and redo at different points in our lives. And everything he has done since his initial unmasking, in fact, demonstrates that his initial political consciousness, which had just started to sprout when he was working with Anonymous, has fully germinated. He has continued to fight against government surveillance in various ways and capacities. He became an intern at the leading NGO in the UK to protect civil liberties, Privacy International. He completed a degree at King's College in computer science, and he's now started a degree at University College London in cryptography. And part of his interest in cryptography is to ensure a technological means for privacy. He's been a very visible and trenchant critic of spy agencies in the UK and the US, often using a strong dose of humor on Twitter. Given Mustafa is now older, engaging in legal politics, it might be tempting to cast the work he did with Anonymous and LulzSec as the less mature type of work, and this current work as the more mature and grown up one. While I admire what he's doing now, and I'm very glad he's no longer putting himself at legal risk, I think it would be a mistake to draw such a neat and tidy line between these two political eras and modalities. Today, Mustafa is here to talk about his days with LulzSec, a breakaway group of hackers, all of whom also worked on Anonymous hacking operations. They were famous for many reasons, including going on a 50-day hacking spree, and we're gonna learn about this tonight. Now, these hacks, along with the hacks done by Anonymous and AntiSec, were important for many, many reasons. And I'd just like to highlight two as I wrap up. Today, we live in an age of such information saturation, where we are bombarded by images, sounds, messages, news, fake news, really fake news, or boring news, that it's really hard to get, much less keep, the attention of the population. What Anonymous and LulzSec did so well is capture our imagination, in part because they were so imaginative. They hacked sometimes to expose weak security, sometimes to expose shady corporate and government shenanigans, sometimes for fun. Sometimes they hacked for all those three reasons. But when they hacked, they did so with style, and they did so with charisma. They created a spectacle with their own homegrown images, video slogans, and very witty tweets and manifestos. They were not just a hacker crew. They doubled as much as a performance troupe who helped spin fantasy and fun for those viewing and following the hacks. And in this way, they're kind of similar to what XNet, which we learned about last night, what they do. Too often, truth is counterposed to drama and fantasy. Truth and fantasy can work against each other, as we've seen with the election of President Trump, who sold a fantasy of a better kind of America to land his presidency. But when truth-telling is mixed with a strong dose of spectacle and drama, it is more likely the message of truth stands a chance to get delivered to an audience who's fed a constant diet of advertising, entertainment, and of spectacular images. As media theorist Stephen Duncombe has put it, and this is a quote by him, reality needs fantasy to render it desirable, just as fantasy needs reality to make it believable. LulzSec and Anonymous married the imperative to expose bad security, to expose truth, with an absurdist and delightful program filled with compelling images, fantasy, and humor. More progressive political groups should turn to the historical example of LulzSec and currently XNet to learn how to better market their message and how to have a great time in the process. Second, Anonymous and LulzSec experimented with the art of hacking in order to leak politically valuable information. I can't get into the history, but Anonymous and LulzSec popularized and stabilized what was a barely existing genre of whistleblowing. It was not obvious to anyone, including Anonymous and LulzSec, that hacking into a company to steal emails could be such a vital avenue for truth-telling. They were willing to experiment
and is often the case with experiments, the collective made mistakes, but they also made new important discoveries as well. Anonymous and LulzSec helped bring into being a new proof of concept. Hacking to leak information can be done in the public interest. Others have taken this proof of concept and have improved upon it. I believe this will be one of their most important legacies. To finish, Mustafa regularly appears on the news to comment on security as well as his past hacking. He's often asked whether he has any regrets. He explains that while he would have done some things differently, admitting to some of the problems of the anonymous and LulzSec mode of experimental hacking, he also stands by many of his actions and hacks. I admire him for both owning up to mistakes but not disavowing his hacker past. With no further ado, please join me in welcoming Mustafa Al-Bassam.
So thank you, Gabriella, for that wonderful introduction. So I want to start a little bit about my background. So I was born in this city, but many of you probably don't recognize it because nowadays, at least the past decade, in the news, it looks very different because this city, for multiple decades, has been war-torn. And this city is Baghdad, and this is where I grew up and lived for the first 3-4 years of my life. And for the past 15 years, I've been living in London. And the reason why I'm telling you this is because I think this is a good introduction to the word hack. Because what is hacking? There's many different types of hacking. There's open source hacking, there's cracking hacking, breaking into websites. But all of these different types of hacking, they all share one mindset of doing playfully clever things or using or abusing a system in a way that the original designer hadn't thought of. So when I was about 4, my family decided to flee the regime of the dictatorship of Saddam Hussein and go to the UK to seek asylum as refugees. But obviously, it's not simple just to go from Iraq to Europe, right? There's many travel issues, visa issues, etc. And it's something that might not even be possible in the first place. So we had to sort of break those rules a little bit. Now, my dad is a doctor, and he was trained in Iraq in medicine. And in Iraq, he basically earned nothing as a doctor. So in order to be able to afford to do any travel in the first place, my family had to move to Yemen, and my dad had to work for a year in Yemen to get some money to travel. Now, the first stage of her journey is not as simple as taking the flight from Yemen to a place in Europe, right? Because you just can't get a visa there as an Iraqi citizen. So what we actually did is we got a visa to Malaysia, which might seem counterintuitive because it's the opposite direction of Europe. But what we did was we booked a two-legged flight from Yemen to Malaysia, where the first leg of the flight is to Istanbul in Turkey. And the Malaysian visa allowed us to book that flight. So when we got to Istanbul, we had someone meet us at the sort of holding area in the airport and give us a ticket to Albania, because in Albania there's pretty much no passport checks when you exit the airport. So that allowed us to travel from Yemen to the European Union without a passport. And to me, that's a really elegant example of a hack, because it's sort of using the system or breaking the rules of the system in a way that the original creator of the system didn't envision. And it was essentially getting around international travel rules. So now I've been living in London for the past 16 years, and now we're British citizens. So growing up in the UK, speaking very little English, I was really attracted to computers. And my first computer was this Dell computer with Windows 95 or Windows 98 on it. And it was pre-installed with this software called Microsoft Front Page, which in those days came with Microsoft Office by default. And I started using Microsoft Front Page to play around with creating websites and HTML, which is the coding language that you use to create websites. And this is how I got into programming. And from there, I learned new different programming languages like Python and PHP, etc., to make websites. And I used to host some of these websites on GeoCities back when that was still a thing. But my sort of first experience of hacking was when I was doing my maths homework one day, and I didn't have a calculator, so I decided to Google for a calculator. And the University of Maryland, I think, was hosting this like Perl-based scientific calculator on their website. Now, having some experience of programming, I sort of thought about how a programmer would design such a calculator, because the most obvious way to design to host an online calculator is in such a way that would be vulnerable. So I decided to see if this calculator was vulnerable, and it turns out that you can actually not only type in sums into this calculator, but you can type in computer code into the calculator to get the server hosting the website to execute computer code. So you can basically compromise the entire website through a calculator, which I found quite interesting. I used to use the Pirate Bay a lot as a teenager, as a child, because it was sort of this way to get software, really expensive software that I might want to use, like Photoshop, etc., without paying the money. Without paying money that I can't afford, essentially. So to me, it was this sort of, I sort of realized the internet is this thing that empowers people to share information freely, beyond borders and beyond legal limits, to essentially empower everyone to have the same information. And I was really sort of inspired by the way that the Pirate Bay went about this, because even though what they were doing was blatantly illegal, they really went about it in a sort of snarky and humorous way, right? So they would get like a ton of legal threats from all these companies like Microsoft, DreamWorks, etc. But instead of just, you know, doing what they say, they would always reply with these really sarcastic and snarky emails to say, well, we're right and you're wrong. So for example, in this email, they replied to this really sort of threatening and scary legal email with an invoice charging them 10 euros for the pants and floors cleaning due to them wetting themselves because of their scary threats. And they also charged them for this for the publishing of the email. So I was kind of inspired by this kind of like snarkiness and sarcastic sense of humor. So one time I was really annoyed by the amount of homework that my biology teacher was setting in class. It was just like a ridiculous amount of homework every week. So and she also had this Google Doc where you could see everyone's homework progress. So you can see who did the homework and who didn't do the homework. And I think the idea was just sort of like, it was like a hall of shame to see for people who didn't do the homework. But she also published a Google Doc containing everyone's test scores in the mock. And that is sort of, I decided to sort of flip that around a little bit, because I created this graph where on the x-axis is the number of homeworks that people have completed, and on the y-axis is people's average test score. And it turns out the more homework you do, the lower your test score. So there's a negative correlation, right? So I showed this to everyone in the class, and people stopped doing their homework. my sort of first experience with hacktivism was when this, when I first heard about hacktivism is when this Indian software company called iPlex Software decided to respond to piracy websites or torrent websites that didn't respond to DMCA requests properly by threatening to launch distributed denial of service attacks against them, which is essentially an attack that you can do to take down a website. And now Anonymous, which was this sort of activist collective that was came out of the image board called 4chan, decided to respond to this, because these guys had a history of protesting against people who tried to stem the flow of free information. Previously, they did that with the Church of Scientology when they tried to remove all copies of a video of Tom Cruise endorsing the Church of Scientology from the internet. And to me, Anonymous was really interesting because it was like a leaderless collective. There was no leader, right? It was just a banner that anyone could use for activism, and it was built on the anarchistic principles of self-organization. So all the operations there were self-organizing. And if you wanted to do something, you would just propose it, and if people liked it, they would support you. So what these guys did was they gave IPX software a taste of their own medicine by launching a distributed denial of service attack against them. And they also expanded their attacks to the wider sort of corporate lobbies like the Motion Picture Association of America and the RIAA. Now, this was also expanded to a distributed denial of service attack against a British company called ACS Law. And ACS Law was this company that was hired by a bunch of porn companies to essentially deal with people who pirate their porn. So what these guys would do is that they would go on BitTorrent and they would see which IP addresses are downloading certain porn, and then they would send a subpoena to their ISP to try and get their real name. But their methodology was completely flawed, because in the UK, most ISPs give people dynamic IP addresses, which means that the IP address constantly changes every time you connect to the internet. So these guys didn't realize that, they realized it, but they probably didn't care. But they were getting names of people that were probably had nothing to do with the porn that was downloaded. So they were targeting people like pensioners or married men who probably don't even know what email is, accusing them of pirating pornography. And something really interesting happened when Anonymous DDoSed them, because the administrator of that website tried to move the website to a different server that can handle the DDoS attack a little bit better. And in doing so, he made a massive mistake, because he accidentally made an entire backup of all the company's systems public on the front page on the website as a directory listing when he was trying to transfer the website. And I sort of saw this, and I copied this, and I uploaded that backup to the Pirate Bay. And some really interesting things were in that backup. For a start, the entire company's emails were in that backup, right? So a lot of interesting revelations came out of that, like the fact that they were basically running a blackmail operation with no intent to take anyone to court. They were just sending people letters threatening to take them to court, but they had no intent of doing so. And as a result, a lot of things happened to that company. They were fined over the data breach, and also the lawyer behind that company was suspended from practicing law for 2 years. So this is when I kind of realized that actually truth-telling and data and leaks really can really have a massive impact, a positive impact on society to expose wrongdoing. So I decided to create this sort of hacking group called Internet Feds, which was like a cell within Anonymous. And I invited like a few people that I saw chatting on a chat room who might have technical skill to that channel. And this, what you see here, is a part of the FBI indictment of Internet Feds 2 years after I founded it. And one of the first things we did was we participated in the Arab Spring, because in early 2011, the Tunisian people were rebelling against their dictator, Ben Ali. And we decided to see how we can help. So one of the first things we did was we compromised the website of the Prime Minister just to send them a message that what they're doing is unacceptable. But what we also did, we also had some Tunisians contact us to say that they suspect that the government is somehow sniffing all the usernames and passwords on Facebook, Yahoo, etc. So we looked into this, and we found out that because in Tunisia there's basically only one ISP that is basically owned by the government, they were injecting like this malicious JavaScript code into all the login pages for Facebook and Gmail, etc., to essentially send the government your username and passwords in an unencrypted format. And you can see the code up here. And if you see, like, it says function HAA. The code even says hacked in leak speak. So you can see how these guys were basically idiots. So in response to that, we created this browser add-on that Tunisians can use and install to essentially make this code go away and ineffective. And a lot of people used it, and this had quite an impact, because here you see a group of Tunisians in France protesting and also acknowledging the work Anonymous did to participate in the Arab Spring. Now, at this point, Anonymous was having quite a lot of attention, and some people wanted to sort of jump on that bandwagon. So there was this company called HPGary Federal, which is a US-based military intelligence contractor that has contracts with the Department of Defense. And the CEO of this company decided to essentially expose Anonymous, right? Because the idea of Anonymous is that everyone's anonymous, you don't know their identities. So he thought that he was clever, and he decided to go in the chat rooms to try and expose everyone. But he completely messed up. He said that there was some guy called Q who lived in California, which is not true, because I met him like 5 years later and he actually lives in Hamburg. But we decided to sort of look into this company, and within like 5 minutes we found a very basic vulnerability on the website, which allowed us to essentially get access to the entire company's emails, right? And these guys just thought that the worst that would happen to them is that they would just get DDoSed, right? They didn't anticipate that we would actually add them and expose all the emails. And that's what we did. And we came across a really interesting presentation in one of the emails that was quite a big deal. And it was this joint project by Palantir and HPGary and also a company called Berico Technologies. And it was titled The WikiLeaks Threat. And the idea was that HPGary and Palantir was hired by this company called, was this law firm called Hunton and Williams to try and essentially attack WikiLeaks on behalf of Bank of America, who suspected that WikiLeaks had information about them. And they essentially like sort of build up this map of people in WikiLeaks, employees, volunteers, etc. And they also said that they also targeted Glenn Greenwald and other journalists who essentially were supporting WikiLeaks. And one of their strategies, for example, was to feed the fuel between feeding groups, to spread this information and to get the movement to split a little bit. And they also wanted to attack the infrastructure directly and also do things like submit fake documents to reduce the credibility of WikiLeaks. And this was quite a big deal, right? Because, I mean, a law firm was hiring a company to actually do this, and this doesn't seem very ethical. So this actually went quite mainstream. And Stephen Colbert did a little piece about it, which I'm going to show you because it's really good.
Folks, is there no sound? I hope you like techno thrillers, because I'm about to tell you a ripping yarn about WikiLeaks and their founder, albino matchstick Julian Assange. You may not know that WikiLeaks is protected by a global hacker nerd brigade known as Anonymous, whose commitment to openness and free exchange of information is right there in the name. Anonymous attacks whoever attacks WikiLeaks. Now, WikiLeaks claims they have incriminating files from a major U.S. bank proving corporate malfeasance. Some speculate that's Bank of America, mostly because Bank of America says, that sounds like us. Now, B of A was worried. Luckily, the Obama Justice Department said, hey, we know a guy who knows a guy who can make your WikiLeaks problem go away. The government introduced them to the law firm Hunton and Williams, who introduced B of A to the CEO of the security firm HPGary, Aaron Barr. Barr, a self-described master of counter-hacking, which evidently meant that he had an email account. Because Barr said he could take down WikiLeaks with cyber attacks against their infrastructure and faking documents to make WikiLeaks look unreliable. But first, he had to take out WikiLeaks' guard dog, Anonymous. Down boy. Barr threatened Anonymous by telling the Financial Times he had collected information on their core leaders, including many of their real names. Now, to put that in hacker terms, Anonymous is a hornet's nest. And Barr said, I'm gonna stick my penis in that thing. Because faster than you can say, get these hornets off my penis, Anonymous took down Barr's website, stole his emails, deleted the company's backup data, trashed his Twitter account, and remotely wiped his iPad. And he had just reached the Hammam High level on Angry Birds. Anonymous Anonymous then published all of Barr's emails, including one from his wife saying, "I will file for divorce," and Barr's World of Warcraft name, Severinsten. That's right. They ruined both his lives. Now, on the plus side, ladies, Severinsten is now single. And he's a level 80 night elf druid with a hateful gladiator's wyrmhide helm. So we know he wears protection on his wyrm. Now, the emails. Barr's emails also reveal that Barr was planning to gather damaging personal information and use it to blackmail WikiLeaks-supporting journalists like Salon's Glenn Greenwald. Now, all of this leads to a disturbing conclusion. The Obama administration's Justice Department advised the largest bank in America where to find a corporate hacker to fabricate information that could be used to blackmail American journalists. And they totally blew it. That proves the government can't do anything right. Well, joining me now to be intimidated by personal information I made up about him is Salon writer, WikiLeaks supporter, and H.P. Gary blackmail target, Glenn Greenwald. Glenn, thanks so much for coming on.
Any accountability. WikiLeaks is one of the very few entities that's shining a light on what's actually taking place and what the Washington
They're
Post calls
bed.
Top secret America.
They're in bed with people like Anonymous, okay? By the way, are you Anonymous?
We're all Anonymous, is their saying. But Aaron
How
Barr
afraid
claims,
should we be of these Anonymous people? How well, afraid should I be of these guys? How powerful are they?
I think they're a lot less powerful than the Justice Department, Hunton and Williams, and the internet security firms that are plotting to destroy the careers of people who advocate things that they dislike, and the world of which they're a part is a lot more powerful than Anonymous. What Anonymous did here is what journalists ought to be doing, which is exposing serious corruption and illegality on the part of the nation's most powerful faction.
So yeah, that was fun. And this had quite a lot of impact because like ACS law, H.P. Gary got quite a lot of flack about it because first of all, the Palantir, which was the company that H.P. Gary was working with, they apologized for the proposal and they completely cut ties with H.P. Gary. And I think actually a few months later, they also fired the main employee that was working on this proposal. And not only that, but also partly thanks to the work of Barrett Brown, Congress actually opened an investigation into the H.P. Gary federal scandal. So this is actually a tangible example of whistleblowing and leaking information actually having a political impact, right? And not only that, but also Aaron Barr, which was the CEO of H.P. Gary, resigned as the CEO of the company. Now, speaking of people who were trying to jump on the attention bandwagon that was going on, someone from Anonymous released this press release proposing an operation to attack the Westboro Baptist Church. And the Westboro Baptist Church, capitalizing on this opportunity, wrote this really funny letter in return, whereby they called Anonymous coward crybaby hackers, and they told them to bring it on. And it says here, a puddle of pimple-faced nerds organized under the cowardly banner of Anonymous claim they plan to hack Westboro's websites. They mistakenly suppose, because of this pseudo success with the ruin and doom of USA's government or financial websites, they can take on the servants of the living God. Miscalculation, girls. And he said, it says at the bottom, God hates fags and lousy hackers. Now, for those of you that don't know, the Westboro Baptist Church is this really controversial and famous church in America, which has these really homophobic, xenophobic views, and they express them in this really sort of attention-grabbing way. So what they do is they, for example, go to the funerals of dead soldiers, and they hold up signs like, "Thank God for dead soldiers," and they also, you know, go to random protests and hold up signs like, "Flag dooms nations." So, I decided to take on this challenge. for fun, and I found Westboro Baptist Church was actually much harder to hack than HP Gary and Sony. Like it was seriously like I had to use a zero-day vulnerability for that. I had to actually look through the source code of software that we were using to find a new vulnerability for that. And I discovered that when I hacked into the server, their server was actually hosted in their office in the church. That's where they were hosting the website. And I scanned the network, and their server was also had access to their printers, to the other computers, the fax machines, etc. So we decided to have a little fun with this. And my friend Jake Davis did a live radio interview with them, whereby we hacked them live on a radio show, which was probably one of the funnest things I've done.
All right, so on Monday we spoke with Shirley Phelps Roper about allegations that the internet gathering known as Anonymous had issued a threat, and Westboro Baptist Church responded to that threat. Well, today we have everybody here. We have Shirley Phelps Roper from the Westboro Baptist Church. We have a source within Anonymous, the internet gathering known as Anonymous, here. So let's start at the very beginning. Anonymous, can you please tell us, did any active Anonymous members or participants, sources, issue a threat to the Westboro Baptist Church?
No, there was no talk of it.
Well, how
the press release
this?
Was...
Well, hold on, Shirley. Let's get him
to
explain.
They're Anonymous, I'm just saying.
Let's have him explain.
Well, Shirley, with most operations, we have planning, we have execution, we have discussion of it. This press release came out of nowhere, and it doesn't seem like the writing style we'd make. Nobody that usually writes press releases stood up and said, hey, we wrote this. The operation came out of nowhere, and you guys responded really too fast. It was all a bit suspicious.
So, Shirley,
yeah,
let's take it one at a time. How did you originally hear of the threat, Shirley?
By many emails. We received many emails. And then, how else? Oh, also in some print publications, Twitter was talking about it. Oh, and Twitter was sending us links to it also.
Okay, so Anonymous, can you state, what is your belief? Do you believe that the Westboro Baptist Church concocted this letter? Do you believe that some third party created it?
It could have been third party perpetrating it in contact with the Westboro Baptist Church.
Is there
trying to get them attention.
Any truth to that, Shirley? Were you involved at all?
Well, now that we're speculating, no, we didn't have anything to do with it. You know that we don't do that. That's not how we roll.
In fairness, you have no time to turn around for nonsense, like you said, but you responded with a kind of an angrily written letter in response really fast.
Wasn't angrily written, hon. It was just plain spoken.
Let's make sure we know, so our audience knows what we're talking about. The letter we're talking about says, bring it. It calls, it refers to lousy hackers. It says, nobody will shut up the words of the Westboro Baptist Church. Shirley, is it your belief that Anonymous cannot harm the Westboro websites in any way?
Okay, now you need to listen to this answer carefully. Take notes, okay? No one, no source, no power can shut these words that are, as the scripture says, roaring out of Mount Zion. I mean, I'm talking to a little guy who's a Jew. You know that when the prophets go, the prophet go time is doomed America's blow time.
Okay, so but then Anonymous, can you address that? I mean, aren't all of Shirley's websites down right now?
Yeah, right now. GodHatesFags.com is down. Your pastor is a whore.com is down. WestboroBaptistChurch.com is down. AmericaIsDoomed.com is down. That's not us, by the way.
Well, okay, so let me see if I got this right. You're wondering if someone really issued a threat and they did it anonymously and then actually attacked our websites? Is that
no,
what I'm hearing?
No, we didn't attack your websites. It was another
dude,
hacktivist.
Potato, potato. You're all a bunch of criminals and thugs, and you're disobedient in the extreme, and you don't obey God, and you're all facing your imminent destruction.
Shirley, let's take this one step at a time, because I don't want my audience to miss a second of this. Anonymous, can you address, did anybody on your end cause all four or five of Shirley's websites, which are currently down, to be down?
No, these were performed by another hacktivist. Credit
four
goes
or five.
To...
We got more than that.
Hold on, Shirley. Let's take it
well,
a step at a time.
The four or five that are down were not our doing. These were the doings of another hacktivist who goes by the name of Jester. He also disagrees with your message. like
oh,
most
you mean
of the world
the military
does.
Guy. What? You're saying that the military people are thugs and criminals too?
No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying
so.
he deserves some credit.
I thought they were heroes. Hello? You've decided you're the one. You're a law unto yourselves. So you're some thugs and some criminals? Lawless bandits? Yes.
Shirley, do you plan... Shirley, do you plan on bringing legal action against those who are attacking your website?
I plan on, if I could just find this guy who's called Jester, I would give him a big hug. I'm talking big. I might even give him a little kiss on the top of his head. That is, if I get to that before God kicks his ass, I'm just saying. Don't you guys understand? Teachers of rebellion get their asses kicked.
And Anonymous, is this talk from Shirley inciting future attacks from Anonymous? I mean, is this riling you guys up to the point where you will actually take action?
Please well, do.
Hold on, Shirley.
Our response against their letter, the original letter we talked about earlier, the Bring It On Crybaby Hackers letter, our response was mature. It was, we don't want to go to war with you. We're busy with Operation Freedom.
Did you just call criminals and thugs mature? Is that mature? You're mature little boys?
But you say the internet was invented just for the Westboro Baptist Church to get its message across, right?
Exactly.
But then how come God allowed gay dating websites?
Silly, that's called your proving ground. Just because you fill it up with filth, you get to explain that in the Day of Judgment, and your destruction is imminent.
I know. Am I going to hell?
Well, hon, I only know what I'm hearing because you're anonymous. God knows who you are, and he knows your heart. And by the out of your heart, your mouth is speaking, and you sound like a guy who's headed to hell. I'm just
well,
saying.
Well, in my lifetime, I've performed over 9,000 sins, so.
Oh, and you keep track? What, do you have a tally sheet?
Yeah, over 9,000 sins. I keep a track.
Okay, well, hon, if you're proud of your sin, how can that possibly fit into a box with repentance? Then yes, the answer is, if God doesn't have mercy on you, and at some point in this short time you have left to live on this earth, he gives you he gives you repentance, then of course you're going to hell.
Internet's a serious business, huh?
Let me try to bring things back to a central point. I think my concern here is
and
what...
And he had it right on the central point. He was spot on.
Hold on, Shirley.
Square on target.
What is there a next step? Is there going to be any further action? I mean, does Anonymous intend to prove that they can, in fact, manipulate the Westboro Baptist Church network of websites? What can we expect going forward, Anonymous?
Actually, I'm working on that right now.
He's working on that right now. Oh, yay. Hey, listen up, ladies.
Well,
this is what
after a response, you know.
Hold on a second. Let's hear from Anonymous, please, Shirley. You will have your chance.
Yeah, no. You keep bringing it back to him.
No, I have something interesting. I have a surprise for you, Shirley. I have a surprise for you.
Wait a minute. You save it for a minute. This is what you've accomplished. You have caused eyes all over the world to look. All we're doing is publishing a message. What you did was you caused yet another huge global explosion of the Word of God.
With us, too. I mean, the anonnews.org, the site that press release was posted on, that site received a 2,100% increase in traffic, a 3,500% increase in ad revenue.
That's interesting. Hold on, everybody. Hold on, everybody. Everybody, hold on. So, Shirley, do you believe that God would be angry with you for bringing positive attention to Anonymous and increased revenue?
Okay, here's what they did. People all around the nation grabbed that news release and they posted it here and there and places you can't keep track of all the places. It went viral. What? Oh, sorry. I'm sorry. My grandson's over here.
A lot happening over there, Shirley.
Well, Roro,
yeah, so
fight the power.
I'm saying
I think I understand, Shirley. So you don't believe that. Anonymous was trying to. I just want to moderate this. Anonymous, go ahead.
I was just going to say, just in the time Shirley was blabbing her religious preach, I actually did some business. And I think if you check downloads.westborobaptistchurch right now, you'll see a nice message from Anonymous.
So hold on. Downloads.westborobaptistchurch.com, is it?
Yeah, we just put up a nice release while Shirley was preaching there.
Just while we were doing this interview.
We had enough. I mean, we responded maturely. We said, no, we don't want a war. Shirley came on the radio, started, well, her thinks I'm going to hell. So we've given her something to look at.
You think that if you try to do something to us, because we tell
something's
you
already been done, check it.
That you
check
have it. To obey, hon, I don't, don't you understand? I have to talk. That's my job. It's somebody else's job to look at the websites. It's not my job.
So hold on. I am getting a thumbs up from my producer that there has been a message posted that appears to be from Anonymous on downloads.westboroughbaptistchurch.com. Anonymous, are you taking responsibility for this?
Yep, we just did it right now, this very second. All these other sites are down.
That is
so
special.
There you go.
That's so special. So are you saying you did take down the websites or you did not take down the websites?
We did this just now. You just told us we can't do anything to harm your websites. We just did. I mean, we were willing to go away.
What I told you is you cannot shut us up.
But so are our words, though.
To summarize here, we're going to have to wrap up. We have heard from Anonymous initially that they did not issue the letter that was spread around the internet by the Westboro Baptist Church. They have denied responsibility for the denial of service attacks. But during this interview, Anonymous has taken responsibility for a message that has been placed on downloads.westboroughbaptistchurch.com. Shirley Phelps Roper seems completely unmoved by it, but I think, is that a fair summary of where we are, Shirley?
Pretty much.
So anyway, this video has 4 million views on YouTube now, which on hindsight is probably what the Westboro Baptist Church wanted, because they thrive on attention. But at the same time, I still think it was worth it because it was pretty hilarious. So a few weeks after that, the internet feds were discovering a lot of vulnerabilities in a lot of different websites and corporations. So for example, we discovered a vulnerability in Fox and also in the X Factor. There was no sort of political motivation behind that originally, right? We just found these vulnerabilities, but we didn't have any activist reason to be exploiting them. But other people wanted to publish them anyway. But I didn't want them to publish it under the banner of Anonymous, because I wanted Anonymous to sort of remain this sort of ground for political action, right? So I proposed this alternative banner called LulzSec, which wasn't supposed to have any political agenda, but was supposed to exist to sort of laugh at the security of corporations, which multi-billion dollar corporations, which have very big security and are not protecting their customers' data properly, to expose that. But I think later on, it did end up being quite political, and I'll explain that, and I'll explain why in a second. But we, in the 50 days that LulzSec existed, we ended up hacking quite a lot of companies. So only Nintendo, PBS, Fox, the US Senate, FBI affiliate InfoGuard, and also the Arizona Police Department, which is actually information that was which is actually a leak provided to me by Jeremy Hammond, I think about 10 days before I was arrested. And you can see here, Ars Technica does some really amusing images of LulzSec. But probably the thing that got the most attention that we did was simply when we launched a distributed denial of service attack against the CIA. And the media completely misinterpreted this as, oh no, the CIA website got hacked. And I think this is kind of like when the authorities really started to pay attention, because this was just super embarrassing for them. And this was so widespread that even SKCD did a comic about our DDoS attack, sort of criticizing the media for misinterpreting the attack, because they claimed that they didn't understand the difference between a DDoS and a hack. But it turns out that for some reason, most people were entertained by LulzSec. Apparently, a poll done showed that 75% of people were entertained by LulzSec. And at one point, we were more popular than One Direction, and we had 300,000 Twitter followers. And Patrick Gray, which is, he writes a blog called Risky Business. He wrote this, I think, this really truthful article about LulzSec and why people like LulzSec. He wrote this article called Why We Secretly Love LulzSec. And he was basically saying that the information security industry has been trying to warn everyone about how weak company security is. But they haven't actually been able to show it, right? Because there's a massive elephant in the room, and they haven't been able to point at it, because it will be illegal to do so. Because companies only actually really start paying attention and start caring when it becomes a PR disaster for them, when the actual information gets leaked. So we did make it a PR disaster for them. And in some way, the information security was felt vindicated by that. And it was so sort of vindicating for them that a bunch of New York security hackers even dressed up as LulzSec for the Halloween party, which was weird. And also, it was like, people apparently were so entertained that some companies pretended to get hacked by LulzSec. So there was this company called Black Bag Security in the US, which pretended to deface their website, pretended that their website got defaced by LulzSec, which was kind of funny, because in my indictment, this was actually listed as one of the hacks. So even the police thought that we actually hacked them, even though they hacked themselves, basically. But I think the reason why people were entertained was because of the way that we did it. We were more of a sort of a comedy group, more than a hacking group. There was a lot of sort of humor in our press releases and everything we did. So, for example, after the news of the world hacking scandal, which the Sun is a part of, we hacked the Sun website and we posted this fake news article saying that Rupert Murdoch was found dead in his garden. And we also posted this article on PBS, this hoax article on PBS saying that Tupac was still alive. And this went quite viral. So we had like this kind of humor in our press releases and in everything we did. And I think this kind of, to me, proves that, this kind of explains to me why LulzSec was political, even though it had no political aim. Because I think what people find funny is also what people find just. Like, people laugh when something bad happens to a massive corporation or bad people. Like, it wouldn't be very funny if we just hacked like a charity or hospital, for example, right? So we actually did find a vulnerability in the NHS, which is the British National Health Service. But instead of exploiting that, we just reported it. But for some reason, that still ended up in our indictment, even though we were trying to help. And 2 years later, there was a play about LulzSec, which was really entertaining. So you can see here in the corner, the six members of that were part of LulzSec were presented by actors on the stage. And here you can see someone dressed up as a pedo bear because all the memes were presented. And then this play was later transferred to South Korea. So the South Koreans somehow I ended up in some sort of situation. Okay, 10 minutes, I have 10 minutes left. Somehow I ended up in the situation where some South Korean actor was playing me for some reason in a play. And I want to show you this video because I think if I was to sum up LulzSec did, this Taiwanese animation group does these like these weekly animations about current news, and they did this really good one about LulzSec.
Lulz骇客集团大闹网际网路，恶名昭彰的 4chan 网站用户向来热爱破坏，这些破坏客并组成了匿名骇客团体。 拒绝服务打击其目标，像是伊朗山达基教会及 Amazon 网站。乐子骇客集团相对的没什么目标，他们完全是为了找乐子而破坏网站。乐子骇客集团最近无法无天，竟为了在推特上耍帅而攻击美国中情局网站，还跟 4chan 的老乡民起哄。 4chan 用户决心要让乐子骇客集团难看，乐子骇客们会不会把他们的电脑技能运用在其他地方呢？
Anyway, so a few months of LulzSec ended pretty quickly because in the midway, halfway through LulzSec, a guy called Hector Mansegur, which was part of the group, who lives in New York, was flipped over by the FBI and Grace was mentioning this yesterday as well. And he was turned into an informant, and he became an informant for like a year, infiltrating anonymous movement and also anti-sec, which later spawned out of the LulzSec. And he was basically essentially sitting in the chat room, recording everything we were saying, and also telling us to do certain things like hack into certain websites, etc., to sort of incriminate ourselves. And so 1 year later, there was an FBI indictment indicting almost everyone that was in LulzSec and some other people. And four of us were in the UK. And I was 16 years old when I was arrested. It was just after I finished my GCSEs, which is the UK equivalent of high school. And they arrested me technically 82 times, because they arrested me once for each offense. So they had to caution me. They were supposed to caution me 82 times, but they got bored halfway through, and so they only arrested me 40 times. And I gave a no comment interview, which is what I was advised to do by my lawyer. But eventually I pled guilty because evidence from Hector, the informant, was too overwhelming. He essentially had logs from the entire chat room for a year. Now I was sentenced, because I was under 18, I was sentenced to, sentence was suspended, so I didn't serve any time in jail. But I was served to 320 hours of community service in a charity shop, which was, I put that on my CV. Because I put that on my CV as volunteering. And I think the other people who were convicted in LulzSec didn't spend more than a year in jail. Jake Davis only spent 30 days. I think Ryan Aykroyd spent only 6 months. And I think Ryan Cleary spent something like 9 months. And this is a massive difference between our co-conspirators, co-defendants in the US. Jeremy Hammond has been sentenced to 10 years in jail. Barrett Brown is still in jail to this day. So there's a massive sentencing disparity here. And I think the US has the harshest sentencing guidelines in the world. And this is why I try to raise as much attention for people like Jeremy Hammond and Barrett Brown as much as possible. And also why I'm trying to support Laurie Love in the UK from being extradited in the US, because he's facing 99 years in jail. And I also want to briefly raise awareness for someone that most of you probably haven't heard about. Lance Moore, which was someone who leaked some, he was an AT&T employee in 2010, 2011, and he leaked some internal documents from AT&T through Anonymous. And after that leak happened, he was arrested by the FBI, and it was so overwhelming for him that he committed suicide in, I believe, March of 2012, 1 month after Aaron Swartz committed suicide. And this was the same prosecutor that prosecuted Weave. So I think this needs more attention, because I don't think he should just be forgotten like that. And also, this is why I think we should support people like Laurie Love and also anyone else in the same position. Because if only he was a little bit more vocal, we could have potentially supported him. Unfortunately, I think for every person that, you know, is at the hands of the US justice system and kills themselves because of it that we hear about, there's many people that we don't hear about. And I think it's really important to make those cases public. So after that, I also, as Gabriella mentioned, I became in activism, legal activism, I suppose, so by interning with Privacy International. And one of the things I did was analyzing the way that GCHQ destroyed the laptop containing certain documents, which I'm not going to go into details, but if you look it up, there's a video of that. But I still enjoy trolling the FBI a little bit. So this FBI agent called Chuck Esposito gave a talk at some conference last year, and he said that apparently the solution to Anonymous is to get them all girlfriends. So I responded, sent in an FBI tip to turn myself in under the condition that they will get me a girlfriend. But unfortunately, they haven't responded. Or maybe they have responded, but I don't know about it. I don't know. I also trolled GCHQ a little bit. So I registered this domain name called gchq.careers, which has a lot of like fake job listings of GCHQ. So for example, one of them is a 0 hours contract for an Ecuadorian embassy cleaner. I'm going to leave it at that. And I'm going to end by copying my friend Jake Davis by saying, if there's one thing that I've learned from this, it's basically don't use the same password everywhere. Thank you.
Is this on? Yeah. Well, thank you so much for that great talk.
It's actually someone who's written research this collective for a long time. I've actually never seen you give a talk live, so it's was really kind of amazing to see. I'm actually just going to turn it over to the audience for questions and comments. All right, as people start thinking about them, I'm going to actually start with a question related to memes and politics. Because one of the kind of fascinating things right now in the United States is how 4chan and certain boards have actually been very popular among the kind of conservative youth in the United States. And there's actually this one board which is about meme warfare as being essential for capturing the youth in the hearts of the minds. And so I wanted to hear a little bit about why you think internet memes is such a good kind of venue and avenue for getting messages across. So I'll just leave it at that.
Yeah, I mean, I think in general, culture and also memes are very important for getting people to support a particular cause. And I think that's where LulzSec and Anonymous were really successful, because all of the operations that we're doing were sort of came with like this. There was lots of artists and people who created image and graphics within Anonymous, and also people that created videos. And this kind of like really boosted the morale of the movement, and also helped us to spread the ideas. I think actually I read somewhere that apparently Al Qaeda was envious of LulzSec because of the way that we were able to handle social media and the media to portray our message.
Yeah, that was actually, I went to visit the Canadian version of the CIA, and they were interviewing me about Anonymous, and someone who worked with jihadis explained to me that jihadists were in awe of all the media attention that Anonymous got. But then one has to wonder whether ISIS, in fact, who is very good at getting media attention as well, right? As is the Westboro Baptist Church, but ISIS was very good on social media and very scary videos. I'm not sure if it was ISIS themselves who actually were looking to Anonymous, or whether we're just in a moment where those who command social media and memes, you know, command people's hearts and minds.
Well, funny story about that, because there was a guy who sort of was involved with Anonymous. I forgot he went by the name of Trick, yes. And he was also arrested. He was also based in the UK. And he was, Junaid Hussain, yes. He was also based in the UK and he was arrested. He had like a hacking history, and he also, based on Anonymous. And he, when he was arrested, he fled to Syria to join ISIS. And he became a hacker for ISIS, funnily enough. And he ended up on being on the Pentagon's top three kill list for ISIS, and eventually, I think last year, he was droned in an illegal drone strike by the British government.
Yeah. Any questions or comments? And feel free also to ask about Anonymous generally, because he knows a lot about it. But I do have another question as well, which is, you know, once people, like a hacker, is arrested, you have to kind of emerge in the public again and explain your past actions, right? And like I mentioned at the end of my introduction, I really do admire the fact that you don't disavow your past. You recognize some mistakes and wish you had done things differently. But I'm just curious to hear whether you do feel like there was pressure from different quarters of your life, maybe professors, educators, parents, friends, family, to more strongly disavow your past, or, you know, So if you could talk a little bit about that.
I mean, I think in the UK, it's very easy to be rehabilitated. Like, I think everyone doesn't have this sort of mindset towards ex-cons that they do in the US. And I think with LulzSec especially, because a lot of the people that I work with and I talk to in the UK, they've heard of LulzSec, and they sort of, they enjoyed it. So they don't see it as something that I should, you know, disavow or something or anything like that. So I've been lucky to the extent that most people I've worked with, they don't sort of criticize me for my past or anything like that. They just accept it, and they don't necessarily think it's a bad thing either.
There is now questions back there. Great.
Does it work? Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. It was really, really interesting. There's one thing that came out also yesterday, and you mentioned that also, which led to your basically being arrested, is the thing about people kind of turning over or becoming informants. So I'd be interested to know about a little bit about how do you build trust, or what does it do to trust? And because, yeah.
Yeah, I mean,
in that kind of environment, and whether that the whatever strategies that people use have changed because of the experience of being spied upon by people you trusted.
Yeah, I mean, I think trust is really important in these communities, because a lot of people say that to have good OPSEC, you should talk to no one, you should collaborate with no one. But the problem is that if you collaborate with no one, you can't get things done, because the best work happens with collaborations. So I think, yes, you should talk to people about it, but you should build trustworthy relationships. But with LulzSec, LulzSec was formed, the people who formed LulzSec, we knew each other for months, and we had worked with each other behind before. So we sort of did already have that trust. We were almost like family, in a sense. And it was a very close group. We didn't just allow any newcomer to come into our group. It was just six of us for the whole time. So we did trust Hector. He was sort of like a very convincing, persuasive person. And unfortunately, I think there's very little you can do, because it's very hard to maintain social OPSEC. So I think you have to sort of be aware of those risks and maintain a balance between collaborations and also keeping things private.
Can I jump in for a second? Because
sure.
I often get asked, like, well, isn't Anonymous more susceptible to informants? Because basically an informant can, from the comfort of their home or air-conditioned CIA office, you know, be logging in, and you could send an army of people, and that's absolutely true. But actually, I think that online hacktivist organizing minimizes some of the threats of informants. Because on the one hand, you do have to trust and like who you work with, and there's a lot of social bonding and joking. And yet, if you're very careful, and it requires almost a kind of militant ruthlessness to not reveal clues about your life, you can pull it off. Whereas with offline organizing, what has happened is that informants often get romantically involved with activists. There's a couple cases in the UK of this happening, one in which the cop had a kid also with an activist. And, you know, it doesn't matter how much cyber sex you have, a kid will never be produced from that act of cyber sex, thank God. And so you can actually create some real barriers in the way that's impossible with offline organizing.
Yeah. Aesthetics has a question, I think.
Thank you for the talk. What advice would you give to a 16-year-old who's thinking about hacking into the Westboro Baptist Church or its equivalent today?
Well, I don't want to be lame and say, oh yeah, don't do it, kids, because that's the obvious answer. But yeah, don't, for legal reasons, don't do it, kids. But look, I think, like, honestly, like, you know, if I was 16 and someone told me not to do it, then I would have still done it. Like, there's nothing like any adult could have told me not to do it, right? The only thing that was prevented me was getting arrested, which I did. So I wouldn't necessarily give them any advice necessarily. But you know, I think, like, it's the job of teenagers to piss off adults. So is it really, you know? Actually, the National Crime Agency, I had a meeting with them, I think, last year, because they wanted me to be in, like, a video campaign that they were running. National Crime Agency. Because they, in the UK, there's a lot of hackers for some reason. Probably because, as Gabriella suggested, it rains a lot, so people have to stay indoors. So there's a lot of, like, kids in the UK who sort of get into hacking and also doing things like benign DDoS attacks, using these things called booters to boot people from online games. And the National Crime Agency has a real problem because there's a lot of them, and they don't just want to prosecute all of them because there's just too many of them. So they've taken a different approach recently, which I really appreciate, and I think it's an example of what the US should be doing. They've decided to go to the approach of educating them or scaring them a little bit rather than actually taking them through the court system and ruining their lives. So what they do nowadays is they just tell their parents about what they're doing, and usually that's enough to get them to stop what they're doing. But they wanted me to be in a video to tell kids to stop hacking. But I refused because I think that would ruin my image.
Thank you again for your talk. Kind of along the lines of combining law enforcement versus kind of hacking, with the rise of Trump, with the rise of a lot more neo-Nazi slash alt-right nonsense in the US right now, do you see a interest in more political hacking to ideally combat some of the messaging that's coming from these groups? Or is that being suppressed by the rise in the FBI chasing these kids down?
Sorry, say that last part again?
Is law enforcement tamping the interest in doing like a LulzSec 2 that is much more political and much more addressing kind of the issues that we're seeing now in terms of the alt-right?
No, I don't think so, because, after LulzSec, essentially Internet Feds was essentially like the first cell within Anonymous that was actually doing data leaking and hacking. And after that happened and LulzSec, there became like an explosion of hacktivist groups within the movement, within anti-sec, trying to hack into corporations and expose wrongdoing, etc. And the FBI had been trying hard to clamp on this, and they did have some effect after it was revealed that Hector was an informant. But since then, there's still been a lot of political activity among hacktivists. We've seen Phineas Fisher, who's, I think, one of the greatest hacktivists of our recent times. And we've also seen a lot of activity in Anonymous nowadays in Latin America and Asia.
But I think her point stands, which is precisely the crackdowns in the United States has meant that US-based hackers are afraid to do anything from the country, and they're smart. And actually, I've talked to some of the Latin American Anonymous hackers, and they have a very smart program where they divide up the labor. So generally, the idea is you should never hack from your home country. So it's kind of like the Five Eyes, but different. So, you know, if something has to happen in Spain, someone else in Latin America might do that hack. I don't know if they're always following through in that way, but I think that is a very interesting division of labor. And there has still been ongoing activity. It's a little bit less prolific, but a lot more careful. Almost no one has been arrested for hacking activity that has happened in the last few years. Is that right?
I think there's been some arrests in Malaysia. Okay, right. But I don't think there's been very arrests in Latin America. I think like they've been surprisingly like open. They're not even anonymous anymore, because it seems that the law enforcement in Latin America is non-existent when it comes to hacking. Like they even host like public hackathons where they like get together and hack in real life, you know. So
other questions? There's a couple back there. Oh, and one there too.
Hi, thanks for your talk. I read that you were forbidden of using the internet for like 2 years after your after your arrest. And how did that work at all? And how did it affect you as a person of the internet, more or less?
Yeah. So one of my bail conditions after I was arrested and before the court case happened was not to use any computer or device that was connected to the internet, which is actually, I think, is a violation of my human rights, because it's pretty hard to get things done in the UK without access to the internet. Because like I couldn't even do my homework, because like all of my homework was sent through email, and like even the marking schemes in some courses in the UK, they actually give you extra points, extra marks for using internet sources. So it's something that's become deeply ingrained within our society. And I don't think it should be allowed to remove someone's right to access the internet. And I think a year after they did that, there was a, I think the European Court of Human Rights released like a statement or something like that, saying that internet access is a human right. So eventually I did challenge it, and the judge changed my conditions to let me use the internet for educational purposes. Educational purposes, yeah. Which is for every purpose, right?
Yeah. I'm going to ask a bit of a nasty question, but it comes out of despair.
Okay.
I'm wondering about the efficiency of actions taken by Anonymous today, and if so, in which direction? For instance, there's been a lot of discussion about misinformation today, and I know that at the time Anonymous engaged in that type of activity, but what we're seeing today is actually the extreme right using these strategies and hijacking them in order to push their product. For instance, Breitbart and personas like Bannon. So I'm asking, in these times which have been already marked as post-truth, are we in that sense post-anonymous? Or what would you recommend for hackers today? What type of activities to combat these types of retaliations? What would be best today? Because
yeah, unfortunately, yeah. There was a lot of information performed by people acting under the banner of Anonymous. So, like, for example, there were a lot of like witch hunts. For example, there was like Op KKK, which was like targeted, trying to figure out the people behind the KKK, the anonymized people. And in almost every single one of those cases, they released the names of innocent people who weren't actually associated with the KKK. And so a lot of innocent people were targeted. And so, yes, there was a lot of misinformation that was spread around Anonymous. And that did sort of reduce the credibility of Anonymous a little bit. But you know, I'm not sure how to answer your question about how to prevent that. I mean, there's been obviously there's been a lot of that recently. But I think Grace's answer yesterday was really good about post-truths.
I mean, also I think, you know, a lot of the liberal media, on the one hand, they were fascinated by Anonymous and couldn't stop reporting on them, but also denigrated them in a lot of ways. And much in the same way, they're doing the same exact thing with the alt-right. And I think that the liberal media has to recognize, again, the importance of drama, spectacle making, and the spinning of kind of fantasy in political movements, either to report about it more accurately. I mean, they really missed the boat with Trump because they're like, well, he's just lying all the time. And they couldn't see that certain groups of people just were really fascinated by how authentic he was in terms of giving a big finger to the powers that be, right? And with Anonymous, I mean, they were reporting on them all the time, but also being like, well, that's not how we should do politics, right? And I think we really do have to enlarge our scope of how reporters understand the nature of politics in some ways. So that's a little bit of a sideway answer, but.
Is it still me? It is. It wasn't exactly my question. Okay. My question was, would you see new strategies emerging by groups like Anonymous to combat this counter-retaliation by the right? Could you imagine new ways, new approaches? Because it seems like the old ones might be now somewhat obsolete inside the current discourse.
Like which ones, which kind of mechanisms, which ones are obsolete, do you think, right now?
Ooh, I get the mic again. Misinformation. Could you use that today in a critical, responsible manner after the flood of misinformation that we've had on Facebook in the past month? Just an example. I'm just curious. I'm hungry for new strategies as well.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, I'd have to think about it because I haven't been in that sort of space for a while. So I've been on the legal side for the past few years, so I'm not sure about legal strategies for Anonymous, but it does seem to me that data leakage is still having quite a large impact. Like what Phineas Fisher did, essentially shut down the hacking team. So it seems to me that's still an effective strategy from my perspective.
Also a question, because I think that speaking about Anonymous and also LulzSec, is important also to understand, since we are speaking about the impact of speaking out, to my point of view also, if there is a political aim in what you were doing or not, because I think that this has been a long debate, is actually Anonymous political or not political, but LulzSec was also something in a sense different because you were also doing some specific attacks. So I wonder, I mean, since you were all really young people, I mean, you were 16, did you see that also as an action related to the reaching of a political impact, or you were doing this for the LulzSec, that means I want you to have fun, but not really have a political perspective? I think this is an important discussion also to make, especially yesterday we spoke about whistleblowing. Would you connect what you were doing as a whistleblowing activity?
Well, I mean, I think activism can be fun too, right? But I mean, I think with LulzSec, as I said, is when we first started LulzSec, it had no political aim, right? It was just, you know, just laughing at company security. But it did end up having a political aim, and that's why AntiSec formed out of LulzSec. Because I think who's funny to attack is also who's just to attack, because people like laughing when bad things happen to bad people. And shortly before LulzSec disbanded, we did put out a press release essentially rebooting the anti-sec movement to call for other hacking groups to also expose wrongdoing within corporations and governments, etc. So it did end up being quite political in the end, despite our expectations.
Claudia has a question back there. Yeah, raise your hand. Yeah, there you go.
Thank you. Well, thanks for the talk. So my question is more like encompassing all of your experience. Do you think that, like, in retrospect, then what has been more gratifying and what has been more effective? Your illegal activism, so to speak, or your legal, quote-unquote, activism of the more recent years?
Yeah.
I mean, as far as you can say until to this point.
So I think they're both rewarding in different ways. So, like, hacking is... It's something that gives you a short-term quick buzz. Like you just hack a website, you leak the emails, boom, impact has happened. So it's like a very like short-term quick thing to do that has quite a lot of impacts, right? Because you know we've seen what happened with HB Gary and ACS Law, for example. But on the legal side, you've also got people like doing things like journalists who spend a lot of time trying to uncover stories about governments and people in power, and you've also got people building crypto tools, and those things, they take a long time. It's not just like hacking a box and leaking emails, right? You have to think much more carefully, and it's a much more long-term game. So like, there's less short-term buzz, and there's like less short-term, I think, reward for it. But I think in the long term, it has much more meaningful impact, and in the long term, it's much more rewarding. Because I mean, you can't keep up illegal activities, you know, permanently.
Thank you. I just wanted to hear from both of you if you have comments on what happened a couple of weeks before the elections in the US when WikiLeaks leaked the emails of Hillary. Like, how would you evaluate like taking that kind of stand from this hacker, from this organization? Thank you.
Well, I mean, it's a complicated situation. I don't know all the details, but if it was me, I would have still leaked Hillary's emails even if I didn't want her to win. Because I think if the moment you decide, okay, I'm not going to leak Hillary's emails because it will help Donald Trump to win, then you're sort of being selective about about who should be politically transparent. I mean, in the ideal situation, both the parties' emails would have been leaked. That's the ideal situation to me, but I don't think it should be one or the other.
Yeah, I mean, I also find this moment very interesting, and I don't think I've worked out completely my views on everything that has happened, but I do think that, generally speaking, having those emails out in the world is a very, very good thing for a lot of reasons, and I would hope that if WikiLeaks had gotten access to the Trump emails, they would have also released those as well. I do think that, you know, the reaction again from certain quarters in the media was very interesting, because some people are like, the only significant thing in these emails was the recipe for risotto, creamy risotto. These are the John Podesta's emails. And yet actually, you know, very important newspapers were publishing very important stories from these emails. These emails actually provide that dramatic narrative that actually can convince people of the fact that, you know, power corrupts and there's these problems. But it precisely takes groups like XNet to really sift through the corpus of the emails. Emails can't just be mined in a week or two. Their significance must be basically harvested over a long period of time. And we need more dedicated groups who are willing to do that work, because journalism just works on a very quick cycle. I do wonder, and this is a little bit of a question, I mean, I get torn myself about whether to publish the whole archive or not, right? And obviously, I would never want one journalistic outfit to be in control of an archive. No way, that's just too much power. But I'm not always convinced that just publishing everything is the way to go with emails. So I'd love to hear your thoughts about that.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a difficult question, and I think there's no right answer. With anti-sec, for example, there was like a new email leak every day, right? And there was just way too much data for the public to handle, and there was actually, I've been looking at this, I've been revisiting those emails like over the past few years to see what's in there. And actually, there's a lot of newsworthy stuff in there that hasn't been reported, because there's just so much of it that people just don't have the time or resources to look through it. So, I mean, leaking information is all well and good, but if there's no one there actually looking into it and producing action based on it, then it's not going to have much of an impact, unfortunately. So I do think it is kind of worthwhile to take a step back a little bit and be slow, yeah.
An additional element, too, is historically campaigns of propaganda, disinformation, and meddling have occurred in extreme secrecy. So the most famous one in the United States is COINTELPRO, which was actually exposed by people who broke into an FBI field office, right? But what was so interesting about the recent DNC email publication was a lot of people were claiming that it was Russia who was maneuvering the situation. And it could have been. It could have been Russian hackers who gave over the emails. But I think it's very interesting that if it were the Russians, it's not a secret. And so all of a sudden, this propaganda question is explicit. And I think that changes the equation in terms of how manipulation happens in ways that we, you know, haven't totally completely understood. I think we have time for maybe one more question. And there was a question up front there. Yeah.
Oh, hi. This is for both of you, and thanks to both of you for a great talk. Do you believe that there are potentially ethical limits in any time to the kind of radical transparency that you're talking about? Like, are there either times in history, political conditions, or elements within emails, for example, that you think would bar you ethically from seeing transparency as a good idea?
It's a hard question. I think, there's been this debate, for example, over transparency, over privacy. So, for example, I think HB Gary is a great example to talk about for this, because HB Gary, for example, was this company that we wanted to provide some transparency for. We wanted to expose what this company was doing. And in doing so, we released all of the emails, right? And that included a lot of personal emails from the CEO, Aaron Barr, and also other employees that weren't really relevant to what we were trying to do. Like, for example, as you saw on the Colbert report, that his wife asked him for divorce. which isn't exactly relevant to what we're trying to expose. So I do think that in that case, for example, there was a unnecessary amount of focus on Avin Barr's personal life and emails, and that would have been I would have preferred seeing shifted to the corporate activities of the companies rather than the personal lives of the employees. And I guess that is something that can be prevented with curation. But again, that requires a lot of resources and a lot of money. So again, it's a trade-off. It's a balance.
Any burning final questions? Well, I think that those were great comments and questions. I think we have a little bit of a break right now. So if you have other questions, you can come up to Mustafa to ask them. But in the meantime, just join me in thanking Mustafa for a great talk and discussion.
Thank you very much. Also, I wanted to remind you that we are going on with the program of today. And so we will meet here in 20 minutes again. And there will be first a short video from Dries De Porter, and then we will have a panel to conclude this event of today. Thank you.